I think that the peer pressure she'll offer does remain within the bounds established by the thesis, and I hope that you will agree that that is so by the time I have finished. Let me begin by affirming that I understand the call to unity within the body of Christ to be a consequence of the mission of God and the right response of the people of God to that mission. Equally, I assume that there is a gospel imperative embedded in any discussion on unity and the mission of God, which flows from John chapter 17. Jesus prays for those who will follow in the apostolic succession. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe. In other words, the prayer of Jesus, that they may all be one, is in order to realize the mission of Jesus, so that the world may believe. On that very simple reading of the gospel, a default understanding is established in which there is an assumption that the unity of God's people will enable the mission of God's people in facilitating the spread of the gospel. Jesus prays for the unity in order to enable that mission, and unity in itself is understood as an expression of the integral relationship between the Father and the Son. We've heard a great deal about what I shall raise next, but I make no apologies for repeating it again. The world in which we live and in which we are called to live out our response to the prayer of Jesus is one that is undergoing profound change in a variety of ways. One dimension of that profound change is what has been called a post-Western Christian awakening. Wesley Granberg Michelson, to give him his full name, suggests patterns of Christian vitality and witness are shifting in breathtaking ways that are reshaping the global religious landscape. And Christianity today seems divided in new ways. On the one hand, are those churches, largely in the north and rooted in the heritage of the East and the West, which have a deep sense of the historic Christian tradition and an ecumenical commitment to what the Nicene Creed names as the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. But these churches find themselves struggling to maintain a resonant and vital witness amidst their modern or postmodern cultures. On the other hand, are those churches largely located in the south, but moving through migration into the global north, which exhibit a vital, even explosive, spiritual power and are propelling a Christian resurgence within their societies and regions of the world? Thereafter, Granberg Michelson suggests that this shift is not only geographical in nature, but also confessional. Thereafter, he notes the growth in modern Pentecostalism as a pervasive phenomenon within global Christianity, alongside a reshaping of the identity of the evangelical community, as it shares in part in the spiritual renewal flowing from the global south. Within the global south, context shapes a witness that is becoming more holistic, integrating personal evangelism and social justice. Meanwhile, the churches whose origins lie in the global north and are associated with the Anglican, Orthodox, and Protestant traditions, as well as the Roman Catholic Church, and which embody the constituent membership of the World Council of Churches, stand in a relationship to the churches of the global south in a way which is not yet fully articulated. They may share in part in the spiritual renewal, and that is to the good. But those churches which are experiencing such spiritual growth and vitality are largely isolated from the structures of the present ecumenical movement, to the impoverishment of both. To those of us who live in the global north, and whose culture is primarily shaped by the Western tradition. The realisation that fresh vitality and growth are reshaping the future of Christianity is at once a cause for celebration and an occasion to lament the seemingly inexorable decline of Christian faith within the Western tradition. The dichotomy between the experience of the global North and of the global South is not one that is easily reconciled among those of us, and I definitely include myself, who are conceptually wedded to the former and have little exposure to the latter. The effect of this dichotomy might be thought to be especially pernicious with respect to our understanding of the nature of mission, especially amongst the churches of the global North. This effect might in turn be thought to have been magnified if, historically speaking, there had been further dichotomies embedded within missional thinking. In seeking to go beyond the dichotomy between ecumenical and evangelical understandings of mission, Joseph Kuhn argues that one of the most significant missiological developments in the 21st century is a convergence between ecumenical and evangelical understandings of mission. But to suggest this is also to acknowledge that there must have been a prior movement towards a situation of dichotomy. And Kuhn helpfully summarizes the dichotomies which have existed within missiological thinking in the 20th century and the historical circumstances in which they arose. He takes the World Missionary Conference in Edinburgh in 1910 as the symbolic point, the symbolic starting point of the modern ecumenical movement. He suggests that the outlook of Edinburgh 1910 reflected in general a traditional, conservative, and optimistic approach to mission, linking the proclamation of the gospel to the heathens with the spread of Western civilization, and identifies this approach to mission as essentially quantitative in nature, The significance of Edinburgh 1910 has been much analyzed, in particular at the Edinburgh 2010 conference to mark the centenary of the former. In reflecting on Edinburgh 10 very briefly and at a slight tangent, it is instructive to note that what was essentially and intentionally absent from the first World Missionary Conference was any consideration of doctrine and church order, which were deemed to be potentially divisive. In other words, at the Edinburgh Missionary Conference in 1910, one of the issues that was bracketed off and not included, intentionally so, was the issue of ecclesiology, the nature of the church. And my own personal view is that one of the weaknesses that has flown in terms of faith and order discussions and in terms of discussions relating to mission is the fact that at a very early point, the nature of the church was bracketed off from the discussions. And that has had consequences, I believe, for an evangelical conception of the nature of the church and its missionary purpose. Kuhn thereafter notes, if that was the mood in 1910, the mood at the Second World Missionary Conference held in Jerusalem in 1928 was quite different. The First World War, provoked by Christian countries, had profoundly challenged the ideal of Western civilization as the embodiment of the gospel. Edinburgh believed that the task of evangelization had essentially been fulfilled in the West, and the missionary obligation was now to go to the unreached territories and to teach the good news of Jesus Christ to the non-Western world. But after the experience of the First World War, this conception was no longer sustainable, and the concept of Edinburgh 10, a quantitative approach to mission, was replaced by a different conception, a qualitative conception. In essence, world evangelization versus a new conception, the kingdom of God, If in 1910 the purpose was to realise the evangelisation of the world in Jerusalem, in 1928 it was to realise the kingdom of God. Thus the dichotomy between world evangelisation and the realisation of the kingdom of God became embedded within missiological thinking, especially as shaped within the Western experience. Skipping on a little, one of the principal and most significant developments within missionary thinking occurred around about 1952 with the conception of the Missio Dei, which was essentially conceptualized at the missionary council held in Villingen in Germany in that year. Coombe suggests that Villingen is rightly considered as one of the conferences that has had the most lasting influence on ecumenical mission theology. The Trinitarian nature of the Missio Dei concept of mission is stated thus. The missionary movement of which we are a part has its source in the triune God himself. Out of the depth of God's love for us, the Father has sent forth his own beloved Son to reconcile all things to himself, that we and all men might, through the Spirit, be made one in him with the Father in that perfect love which is the very nature of God. So the conception of the Missio Dei occurred, as I said, in 1952 and has supplied since then the concept of mission, which is essentially undergirds the conception of mission held within the World Council of Churches, and that continues to this day. Developments thereafter within the International Missionary Council, which joined with the World Council of Churches in 1961, became, however, more fraught. And in 1972 and 1973, an assembly held in Bangkok had a focus on contextualization, holistic salvation, and a subsequent discussion on a moratorium on missionary activity, which effectively polarized the missionary community and missiology for a generation thereafter. The effective result of this dichotomy and the consequent polarity was the establishing of the Lausanne movement and the promulgation of the Lausanne Covenant in 1974. Coombe suggests that in 1974, for the first time since the unity of Edinburgh, world mission was visibly divided into two groups. We're to turn now to look at the response of the evangelical community as embodied within the Lausanne tradition. I'm giving an account of the response of the evangelical mission community to the developments within the International Missionary Council and the World Council of Churches, which led to this dichotomy, and in setting out the rationale of the International Congress on World Evangelization held at Lausanne in 1974, John Stott states, "It was said that when the International Missionary Council became the missionary arm of the World Council of Churches, mission would be at the heart of the Council's concern and of its member churches. In the event, however, mission became marginalized by being largely reinterpreted in socio-political terms. Thus, the vision of Edinburgh 1910 suffered an almost total collapse. The Lausanne Covenant consists, as I'm sure many of you know, of a series of 15 propositions setting out an evangelical understanding of the nature and purposes of God in relation to mission and evangelism. With respect to the theme of unity within the body of Christ, the covenant addresses this under the heading, and solely under the heading, of cooperation in evangelism, and states, we affirm that the church's visible unity in truth is God's purpose. Evangelism also summons us to unity because our oneness strengthens our witness, just as disunity undermines our gospel of reconciliation. Equally, we note the assessment given by Timothy C. Tennant with respect to the Lausanne Statement on Unity. It states, one of the great hallmarks of the Lausanne movement is its desire to transcend issues which have divided the church and find our deepest unity in the core gospel message. The Lausanne movement is simultaneously an evangelical movement as well as a profoundly ecumenical one. However, the covenant immediately itself caveats this affirmation with reference to forms of organizational unity that do not necessarily forward evangelism, while stating that we who share the same biblical faith should be closely united in fellowship, work, and witness. I would judge that the covenant, insofar as it does deal with the concept of unity, is primarily focused on the mission of the church in relation to the task of evangelism, rather than on the development of an evangelical ecclesiology. And I would suggest that that is one of its possible weaknesses at this point. The covenant is stronger on an ecclesiology of the local church than on an understanding of wider conceptions of a universal church. In reflecting on the role of the Lausanne Covenant, Tormod Engelsviken, I wanted to say that, suggests that although the covenant was never intended to be a confession in a classical sense, yet it has the same characteristics as important confessions of the Reformation. He suggests that the covenant has five characteristics that make it justifiable to call the Lausanne Covenant a confession in a somewhat loose sense. In the first instance, he suggests that the covenant was an answer to a serious threat to biblical, classical, Christian doctrine with particular reference to mission. Further, the covenant reflects a broad consensus on mission among mission and church leaders from around the world. Thirdly, it invites personal acceptance, endorsement, and commitment. Fourthly, the covenant with its Irenic, evangelical, and ecumenical form has served as a theological basis for many organizations throughout the world. And finally, it has functioned as such over an extended period of years. The Lausanne Covenant was followed by the Manila Manifesto in 1989. For reasons of time, I shall skip over that. And then in continuing to consider the contribution of the Lausanne movement, let me turn to the Cape Town Commitment of 2011. If a reading of the contribution of the Lausanne movement to date, the Lausanne Covenant may be regarded as having established and articulated an evangelical understanding of the Christian faith and as having established a particular evangelical tradition. Further, it has acquired a quasi-confessional status within the evangelical community, which has been maintained to date. In looking at its most recent contribution, the Cape Town Commitment, a confession of faith and a call to action, we see that as the product of the Third Lausanne Congress held in Cape Town in October 2010. It brought together over 4,000 evangelical leaders from around the world with the following goal: to bring a fresh challenge to the global church to bear witness to Jesus Christ and all his teaching in every nation, in every sphere of society, and in the realm of ideas. Within the methodology of the Cape Town Commitment, we find that it has two parts. Part one sets out the scriptural and theological confession of faith, which serves as a basis for a part two, the call to action. Part one was prepared under the auspices of the Lausanne Theology Working Group, chaired by Christopher Wright, and part two was the consequence of an international process of consultation. The Cape Town Commitment begins by its affirmation of the oneness of the body of Christ. recognizing also that there are other followers of the Lord Jesus Christ within other traditions. So it begins with an ecumenical acknowledgement of the breadth of the Christian community. It stands self-consciously in the same tradition of the Lausanne Covenant and of the Manila Manifesto. But equally and inescapably, it acknowledges the enormous shift in world Christianity since the Edinburgh Missionary Conference in 1910. Much returns us to Edinburgh and to 1910. And it acknowledges that the centre of gravity within world Christianity has indeed shifted from the global north to the global south. In assessing the extent to which there has been a movement within the three Lausanne movement documents, Robert Schreiter takes the Lausanne Covenant, the Manila Manifesto, and the Cape Town Commitment and asks, has there been any discernible shift within these three documents? Schreiter notes that evangelicalism is not itself monolithic by nature, albeit that there is a commitment to certain shared fundamental convictions, and that there is an inherent diversity within the evangelical community. That said, he understands the documents of the Lausanne movement to be themselves consensus texts in which the inherent diversity is nevertheless unified in these texts. Schreiter notes that the movement is expressed in its foundation document in covenant language and suggests of the 1974 Lausanne Covenant, with covenant as the frame for Lausanne, we see that the document therefore speaks more to the participants and of course to God than to the general public. So in the first instance, he suggests, rightly or wrongly, that Lausanne speaks to the evangelical community. It is a document aimed at their self-understanding and self-motivation for mission. And like the covenants in the Hebrew scriptures, it tends towards dichotomous language about what should and should not be believed. He suggests that this preference for dichotomous language has a long history in evangelicalism, with its emphasis on personal conviction and total commitment to Jesus Christ. It can also function, he says, as a kind of shorthand or indicator to an in-group about its most deeply held convictions. In turning then to the Manila Manifesto, Schreiter discerns a shift in the language and genre of the text and understands it more as a public proclamation of a group to explain its past actions and to give its intention for future action. As such, it moves the more in-group approach of Lausanne towards a more outward-oriented message. In turn, Schreiter notes that Cape Town in 2011 produced a commitment in two parts, a confession of faith and a commitment to action. It is a far more extensive document than the two previous documents. It moves away from the preference for dichotomous language to a more essay-like mode. In so doing, it leaves behind the more propositional approach of 1974 to embrace a more nuanced presentation of its confession and its commitments. With respect to the theological understanding of the nature of mission, Schreiter suggests that the propositional model used in the Lausanne Covenant and the Manila Manifesto uses a series of affirmations which invite an answer. In contrast, the Cape Town Commitment does not use propositions or affirmations. The confession of faith is principally a narrative of God's action in the world, one which is framed by two theological concepts, love and reconciliation. Schreiter suggests that what is striking in the Cape Town Commitment is how much more there is of a conscious theological basis for the entire document, such that this more comprehensive theology allows for a more nuanced engagement with the world. If the Lausanne Covenant and the Manila Manifesto are self-consciously shaped by a reformed theology of the fall of Adam and Eve that emphasizes the utter separation between God and the world because of their sin, the Cape Town Commitment is similarly shaped. However, Schreiter suggests that the Cape Town Commitment takes a different approach by framing the biblical narrative of God's action in the world primarily with reference to the theme of love. It does not deny sinfulness by any means, but placing emphasis on loving the world as God has made it is striking. We humans do not love sin, but we love the whole of creation and the world that exists within it. In other words, Schreiter discerns not a change in substance within the Manila movement, but a change in the form in which that substance is expressed. I want now to turn to something of the content of the Cape Town Commitment, and to look first of all, of course, at part one, and to one of the sections of part one, namely that section which focuses on we love the people of God. Part one is entitled, For the Lord We Love, the Cape Town Confession of Faith, and there are 10 sections, each one framing that biblical narrative of God's action in the world. We should look at we love the people of God, and then we love the mission of God. The theme of unity is highlighted where it is affirmed in the commitment. Love calls for unity. The command of Jesus that his disciples should love one another is linked to his prayer that they should be one. Both the command and the prayer are missional. That the world may know you, that you are my disciples, and that the world may know that you, the Father, has sent me. This simple reiteration of our opening theme captures profoundly the inescapable implications of the Gospel of John in chapter 13 and in chapter 17, that the unity of God's people and that the mission of God are inextricably linked. The commitment states, a most powerfully convincing mark of the truth of the gospel is when Christian believers are united in love across the barriers of the world's inveterate divisions, barriers of race, color, gender, social class, economic privilege, or political alignment. Once more, the implications of the Johannine theme are spelt out in terms which ought to resonate with us and to invite our assent, and might reasonably be understood as a call to repentance where we have failed to reckon with the implications of the prayer of Jesus. If we have chosen not to reckon with these implications, we must reckon with the consequences. When, quote, few things so destroy our testimony as when Christians mirror and amplify the very same divisions among themselves. A further implication affirmed by the commitment is that in recognition of the gospel imperative, we must urgently seek a new global partnership within the body of Christ across all continents, rooted in profound mutual love, mutual submission, and dramatic economic sharing without paternalism or unhealthy dependency. In seeking this global partnership, the Cape Town Commitment acknowledges the need to honestly confront our failure to love and to repent so that we can be restored to the service of God's mission. This is so for the very simple reason that our love for the Church of God aches with grief over the ugliness among us that so disfigures the face of our dear Lord Jesus Christ and hides his beauty from the world. Once more, it is integral to this global partnership that we stand in solidarity, especially caring for those who are persecuted and in prison for their faith and for their witness. So in framing the biblical narrative of God's action in the world, in terms of love, and doing so for the Lord we love, the Cape Town Commitment articulates its understanding of what it is to love the people of God in terms grounded in a conception of unity, which at once calls for repentance and invites us to stand in partnership and in solidarity with the Church in its varied global expressions, for the sake of the name of Christ and the mission of God. In framing a confession of faith in these terms, we find that the commitment takes up a traditionally Reformed conception and transposes it into a different key. It takes up a traditional Reformed conception and transposes it into a different key. The confession of faith serves not as a boundary marker which delineates the Church from the world. Rather, it serves as an affirmation of the boundless commitment of God to the world. In this world, the Church, which hears the command to love one another and is sustained by the prayer of Jesus, finds its missional vocation as it seeks out to live, as it seeks to live out the imperative of the gospel narrative. The following section of the commitment is entitled, We Love the Mission of God. And in turning to this, we find ourselves in territory previously conceptualized within the evangelical tradition, especially by Christopher Wright in his book, The Mission of God, Unlocking the Bible's Grand Narrative. And indeed, the key to understanding this further section of the commitment is this conception of the narrative understanding of the mission of God. God's action in the world is narrated with respect to the action of God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It is interesting to note that neither the Cape Town Commitment nor Christopher Wright himself makes use of the concept of the Missio Dei. It is always a reference to the mission of God, and Wright himself understands the concept of the Missio Dei to be itself essentially problematic. He offers an economic narrative of the mission of God. The whole Bible reveals the mission of God to bring all things in heaven and earth into unity under Christ, reconciling them through the blood of the cross. Equally, this narrative is founded on the covenantal promises given to Abraham and fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And that covenantal basis in the promises given to Abraham is of particular significance, for it is this breaking down of the walls of division which serve as a paradigm thereafter for every example where God breaks down the barriers of division. So the breaking down of the barrier between Jew and Gentile serves as a paradigm for our understanding of the nature of mission. If that is part of the confession of faith aspect of the Cape Town Commitment, we turn to the affirmations that come, or the commitments that come in the second part of the Cape Town Commitment. It has six sections, and we shall focus on two parts. One, building the peace of Christ in our divided and broken world. And that takes up the theme of reconciliation with respect to the relationship between Jew and Gentile. And as I said, the peace of Christ is made through the cross and addressed in the first instance to the divided world of Jew and Gentile. It is this which serves as a paradigm for the unity of the people of God. The two have become one. Specifically, with respect to the Jewish people, the Cape Town Commitment contends that the Jews were not strangers to the covenants of and promises of God, and still stand in need of reconciliation to God through the Messiah Jesus. Just as Jew and Gentile are not to be differentiated with respect to the nature of their sinful predicament, neither is there any difference in salvation. Only in and through the cross can both have access to God the Father through the one Spirit. And there is affirmed a commitment for the whole church to continue the mission of the church towards the Jewish people. In moving on to a further section of the Cape Town Commitments, partnering in the body of Christ for unity and mission, we see that it takes up immediately the narrative established. Paul teaches us that Christian unity is a creation of God based on our reconciliation with God and with one another. This double reconciliation has been accomplished through the cross. The commitment states, simply and starkly, that a divided church has no message for a divided world. Equally, it contends that a failure to live in reconciled unity is a major obstacle to authenticity and effectiveness in mission. And we note here that the Cape Town Commitment uses a concept, reconciled unity. And as stated here, it may serve as a helpful counterpoint to the concept of reconciled diversity, which is often commonly affirmed in ecumenical statements. The use of reconciled unity affirms that which is in the first instance primary, namely unity, and may be said to offer a counterpoint, as I said, to the usage found in other ecumenical statements. The implications of this understanding of the nature of unity for partnership in global mission is that it takes the traditional concept of a confession of faith and then implicitly criticizes it in stating the supremacy and centrality of Christ in our mission must be more than a confession of faith. It must govern our strategy, practice, and unity. The confession of faith, which affirms the supremacy and centrality of Christ, finds its contemporary context in the call to action, which is the response of the people of God to the mission of God. In conclusion, I began by affirming that I understand the call to unity within the body of Christ to be a consequence of the mission of God and the right response of the people of God to that mission, on the assumption that there is a gospel imperative embedded in any discussion on unity and mission which flows from a reading of John's Gospel. In assessing the contribution of the Lausanne movement, I have focused on those sections of the Cape Town Commitment which primarily articulate the theme of unity and the mission of God. In conclusion, I believe that what the Cape Town Commitment primarily offers in this regard is, one, in the first instance, a narrative of God's action in the world, within which the significance of love for the people of God is set in the context of a confession of faith, and three, the theme of reconciliation set in the context of a call to action. In affirming the primacy of the prayer of Jesus within the context of the call to love, the Cape Town Commitment takes the narrative of the Gospel of John as a framework for understanding the nature of God's action in the world in theological terms. In linking the commandment to love one another to the prayer of Jesus, it the Cape Town Commitment affirms both the command and the prayer are missional. Once more, may I suggest that this reflects a transposition in the function of a confession of faith, from being in the first instance a marker of boundaries for the sake of the faithful, to instead becoming an affirmation of the limitless love of God for the sake of the world. This transposition may be said to be effected through the contextualization of the confession of faith and it being lived out in the call to action. Thus, the confession of faith is to be understood as a living out of that which Christ has accomplished on the cross, as a result of which the dividing wall of hostility is broken down. Once more, this work, this model of the reconciling work of God, serves as an exemplar of God's action in this world. Further, the concept of reconciled unity affirms the primacy of unity in living out our missional call to action. In conclusion, the Cape Town Commitment affirms, when Christians live in the reconciled unity of love by the power of the Holy Spirit, the world will come to know Jesus, whose disciples we are, and come to know the Father who sent him. Thank you.